Hare Krishna. So today we discuss the concluding part of this analysis based on the Bhagavatam of how Krishna's power to heal is greater than the world's power to hurt. I talked in the first session about how when our own small mistakes lead to big problems, then we have to forgive ourselves so that we can give ourselves to Krishna. Dr. Parikshit Maharaj didn't keep beating himself up when he offended Shamik Rishi. Then in the last session I talked about when somebody else seems to be on a mission to destroy us, to hurt us. At that time, we have to see that problems are not always obstacles on the way. Problems can also be the way, because they can help us to move forward in recognizing that I am not the doer. And bhakti is not just about doing things, but about recognizing that I am not the doer also. So that I discussed based on the Gajendra pastime analysis. Today I'll talk about the problems that probably cause us the maximum agitation. That is, the problems that come when we try to do something good. One situation is where we have made some mistake and then some problems are coming because of that mistake. Second situation is that we have not done any mistake, but somebody, while we are just going through our normal life, somebody attacks us. Somebody becomes our enemy. Third is, we are going out of our way to do something good, and because of our attempts to do something good, somebody troubles us. So that is very difficult to bear. Because first of all, to do anything good is difficult, because we have to go out of our way many times. But when we are troubled because of that, then it becomes almost impossible to bear. Such was the predicament of Prahlad Maharaj. Prahlad Maharaj, he was a normal small child. And his only, you could say, his only quality that antagonized his father was his devotion to Krishna. And his devotion actually is a wonderful quality. And for a child to have that quality is extraordinarily wonderful. But it was because of his devotion that his father became so angry with him. Hiranyakashipu wanted to attack and even assassinate Prahlad. In the 7th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, this story is told by Yudhishthira Maharaj, by Narad Muni, Yudhishthira Maharaj is astonished. He says, how can any father become the potential murderer of his own son? It's unheard of. So the Bhagavatam actually at one level demonstrates the inversion of all normal hierarchies. The inversion of normal hierarchies means, normally, say, the devatas are considered much better than Danavas. But the Bhagavatam describes a Danava, a Rakshasa, who is better than a Devata. Who is that? Ritrasur. Ritrasur is depicted as a far greater devotee than the, not just a Devata, but the king of the Devatas, that is Indra. Similarly, normally, Brahmana is considered to be much higher than a Kshatriya. Renunciate, a Sannyasi is considered much higher than a Grahastha. But the Bhagavatam depicts how a Grahastha and a Kshatriya is higher than a Brahmana and a Sannyasi. Which pastime is that? Ambarish Maharaj and? Durvasa Muni. So what the Bhagavatam is depicting is that devotion can invert all hierarchies. There are hierarchies in society, and some positions are considered higher and some are considered lower. But devotion can invert all hierarchies. Similarly, if we consider that way, the 10th canto itself, the wives are normally said to be working in subordination and cooperation with their husbands. But if the husband is not devoted to the Lord and the wife is devoted to the Lord, then the wives are considered to be higher than the husbands. Which pastime is this? Yagik Brahmana Patnis. So where the Brahmanas are so caught in the ritual that they forget the purpose of the ritual. So the Brahmanas are caught, Brahmanas' wives are caught in ritual, but the Brahmanas are actually spiritual. So that's how the Bhagavatam inverts all hierarchies. So much so that even if your guru is not devoted to Vishnu, then the disciple can become greater than the guru. Which is the pastime? Bali Maharaj and Shukracharya. So of course Shukracharya is not exactly a spiritual master. He is more like a priest. But for practical purposes, the priest is also considered a guru. So normally, similarly, the father is considered to be a normal guide, protector, teacher of the son. But the son is shown to be much greater than the father in this pastime. So the Bhagavatam is not, in a sense, against normal society, normal social structures and normal dharmas. But its stress is that the paradharma is the most important. The paradharma is devotion to the Supreme. So on one side, Prahlad, he was just a wonderful devoted person. And his father, Hiranyakashipu, was out to terrorize and destroy his own son. Now all that Prahlad had to do was just give up his devotion. And his life would have been wonderful. Most people go to God to have their problem solved. Now I have this problem, I have this problem, I have this problem. Please have this problem solved. Please solve this problem. That is a normal, we could say, the karmakanda level of worshipping God. Prabhupada explains in one purport, how do we know that we are Krishna conscious? What is Krishna consciousness? So he says that if you come to a temple and you look at the deities and you feel the deities are asking us, what are you doing for me? What are you doing for me? What is the service that you are doing for me? If we feel that the deities are asking us, what are you doing for me? Then Prabhupada says we are Krishna conscious. So Prabhupada was very practical. Prabhupada did not say, oh, we are chanting 16 hours, chanting constantly Hare Krishna, absorbed in the remembrance of Krishna. Yes, all that is important. But that can just be otherworldly or sentimental also. Bhakti is about a personal relationship with Krishna, and that relationship is based on servitorship. So we are all meant to do something for Krishna. Now, most people when they come to the temple, instead of feeling God asking to them, what are you doing for me? They feel like asking God, what are you doing for me? I have this problem and that problem, that problem. It's not being solved. What are you doing for me? So that's the normal way of relating with God for many people. So if we come to God and we have a lot of problems in our life and we expect that, okay, by worship of God, my problems will go away. But if because of the worship of God our problems increase, then naturally, why worship God at all? For most people who do not have a proper spiritual understanding of life, today God is like an optional add-on to their life. It's like optional add-on. Like if you're using a computer browser or something, then you can add some plugin into it, add some extension into it. So they feel like God is an optional add-on. If you want, you can have it. One of my uncles, he often tells me, he says, you know, I believe in God. He says, he is happy there, I am happy here. Now, yes, we may be happy here right now, but how long are we going to stay happy? This world, happiness can change into distress in one moment. So normally, if we look at the surface of reality, we'll feel that the only reason for approaching God is that I have problems, and if God can solve my problems, then I'll go to God. And if He doesn't solve my problems, then what is the use of going to God? Now in the past, people had shortages of supplies. So there were prayers like, oh Father, Thou art in heaven, give us our daily bread. That made sense. Now most people don't worry so much about bread. They feel that, okay, that I'll get. So many people go to God, not so much for physical needs, but for psychological needs. That means, for example, mainstream Christianity, many people expected that in the Western world religion would die out. But mainstream Christianity now portrays God not as a cosmic supplier, but as a cosmic therapist. If you go to God, you'll feel good. Your negative emotions will go away. You'll feel peaceful. You'll become positive. Now that is true also at one level. By God, becoming devoted to God, we will become peaceful. But if you understand both physical need like food, bread, or psychological need like peace, these are both peripheral to the soul. They are both peripheral to the soul. That means when we go to Krishna, we go to Krishna not because of what he provides us, but because of who he is. The Vrajavasis love Krishna so much that Mother Yashoda is often in anxiety. When it's time for Krishna to come back home, and she says, Krishna has not come back home. What has happened to Krishna? She's peering out of her house, looking at the forest path from which Krishna is supposed to come. She doesn't even have a phone to check with the SMS. Where are you, Krishna? When are you coming back? You know, so she's worried. So our relationship with Krishna is a rich relationship. And a rich relationship has a whole gamut of emotions in it. And that's why in the relationship with Krishna, there is anxiety also included. A devotee, so Yashoda Mai, she's worried. When Krishna starts crying, she's not peaceful. She's worried, why is Krishna crying? When she's feeding Krishna milk from her breast, at that time when she starts seeing the milk overflowing, she's worried, oh, if this milk overflows, what will I feed Krishna? How will I make sweets for Krishna? So a devotee, when devotees are absorbed in Krishna, then that absorption in Krishna gives a whole gamut of emotions. Everything that will make a rich relationship in this world, that is present in its purity and its fullness in the relationship with Krishna. In general, in our relationships in this world, for a relationship to be, to stay stimulating and fulfilling, there has to be a healthy blend of predictability and unpredictability. That means, if you are relating with someone, after some time you understand how this person is. But if that person is entirely predictable, if I say this, this person is going to say this. If I do this, this person is going to do this. If I do like this, this person is going to do like this. After some time, I feel it's like dealing with a machine. It just becomes completely predictable. Then it doesn't stay very stimulating. But then, if that person is completely unpredictable, we say one thing and there's no idea what they're going to say, how they're going to act. Then it becomes like relating with that person like walking in a minefield. You know, what word or what step is going to cause an explosion, you don't know. So if the relationship is totally unpredictable or totally predictable, it's not very stimulating. So there's a healthy blend of predictability and unpredictability that makes the relationship stimulating. So In we do want peace, but if peace is all that we want, then why do we need any relationships at all? Is it relationships? Actually, just having any relationship means a certain amount of uncertainty comes in our life. Because we don't know how the other person is going to respond. So basically, the point I'm making is that for Prahlad Maharaj, if he had been practicing his devotion for getting anything material, be it physical or be it psychological, then devotion would make no sense at all. Okay, what am I getting? What am I getting physical from Krishna? Nothing. Everything that I am getting, my father Hiranyakashipu is providing it. What am I getting from Krishna? Peace. But my father is persecuting me. Where is my peace? So yes, initially we may come to Krishna for something other than Krishna, which is fine. But if we want our bhakti to become steady and our understanding has to evolve, that Krishna's greatest gift is Krishna himself. Krishna's greatest gift is not any big position in our life, not wealth, not power. Krishna's gift is also not peace of mind. Yes, it's not that we should deliberately disrupt our peace of mind. It's not that. But the point is, if Srila Prabhupada wanted peace of mind alone, he could have stayed peaceful in Vrindavan. When he came to America, for the first time, an old person coming to a place where he doesn't know anyone at all, and going and staying with people who were past drug users, somewhere even present drug users. So it was a lot of anxiety. So there is a purpose to life which can even make anxiety worth bearing. Every relationship, and we take up some anxiety because we want
recording. Who started?
Okay. Should I be in anxiety? So, if we form relationships, when parents have a child, having a child, there's so much anxiety associated with that. But then along with the anxiety comes the fulfillment of taking care of a new life, helping that person child to grow up. So, in bhakti, if we come to Krishna only for peace of mind, then after some time we fall, bhakti is not really giving much peace of mind. Sometimes we feel that I'm doing some services, and before we do any services, all devotees seem to be very nice. But once we start doing some services, tell you do this, I'll do this, and then devotees forget to do the service, or this problem comes up, that problem comes up. Start feeling, okay, when I come to a temple, I start getting so much anxiety. Is this done or not? Is that done or not? What is this happening? What is that happening? So if our purpose is peace of mind, then sometimes bhakti yoga may seem to be actually taking away our peace of mind. So what would motivate anyone to practice bhakti at such a cost? We're talking about when problems come in our life. So if somebody who's an enemy, that person hurts us, it's still hurtful, but it's to be expected. Now if a person is playing a boxing match and the opponent punches, the punch hurts, but that's to be expected. But say the boxing round is over and this player goes back to his coach and his coach punches him. Hey, what happened? You didn't expect that, isn't it? So that will shock, that will alarm, that will hurt. So often how much we are hurt in a particular situation, that is a function of expectation. So we understand that some people's values are different from ours. So if you are practicing spiritual life, sometimes people who are materialistic, they will oppose us. That will create some trouble for us. But when sometimes we are practicing spiritual life and our very practice of spiritual life seems to be the cause of our trouble, because we are trying to do some service for Krishna, that is why, say, some other devotees may feel that they're not cooperating with me, they're not understanding what I'm doing, they're obstructing me. Then when our devotion itself seems to be the cause of our agitation, then we may start, why am I doing this? What is the point of doing this? Now bhakti. Now here I'd like to talk about peace of mind from three different levels. One is the peace of mind that comes from being in a peaceful situation. So for example, people may go to a beautiful natural scenic place where you can see the birds chirping, the wind moving, causing the leaves to swirl in the sky. There is nice river flowing below, we can feel the breeze in our ears, and just seeing the beautiful scenery calms us down. So by going to an external peaceful situation, we can get some peace. That is one level of peace. It is good sometimes to go in such a situation. That sattvic situation can create a sattvic disposition. So going like that is one level of peace. Just being in a peaceful situation brings peace. Another could be that by cultivating a peaceful disposition internally, there is peace at a physical level, which originates from the physical level. The another is we remove from our mind the things that steal away our peace. So the anarthas that are there within all of us, they actually steal away our peace. If there is anger within us, there is lust within us, there is greed within us, there is envy within us, then even if our external situation is peaceful, if somebody is an alcohol addict, but they may be sitting peacefully on top of a mountain, but they will not be peaceful. Where can I get a drink? Where can I get a drink? Where can I get a drink? So the agitation is caused not by the situation, but by the disposition itself. So if within our mind there are things which agitate us, then we need to remove those to become peaceful. So that is another level of peace, which is more internal, through purification. Now, as long as if internally there is lust, anger, greed, even if we go to a peaceful situation, we will not be able to stay peaceful for long. Why? Because our mind will agitate us. Mind will drag us here, there and everywhere. Sometimes we may feel that, oh, you know, I'm doing so much service and the service is causing so much anxiety. I don't want to do any service. I just want to practice bhakti peacefully. See, that can theoretically seem very nice. But what happens is that the mind is still there. When we say, okay, I'll not do any service. I just want to peacefully come to the temple, chant Hare Krishna, hear some classes, take darshan and go back. I don't want any service. It may seem good, but the problem with that is that our mind is still passionate. Mind is still in Rajoguna. And if the mind is in Rajoguna, it will always express itself in some way or the other. So suppose, say we decide, okay, I am going to, there's a kirtan program and we decide we'll do a part of a kirtan group. And then if we have good voice to sing, we learn to sing nicely. And then we go for programs, but going for any program, there's some anxiety, get on time, get the team on time, everybody together. Feel, and then we think, okay, yeah, it's just too much, I don't want to do this. We give it up. But then there is that craving to do something. When we are in passion, we want to do something tangible. Devotion is internal, but devotion is not just internal. Devotion is also an external activity. And for all of us, the internal purification is something which is not so easy to see. It takes time. So therefore, if we get some external results also, that gives us some taste of success to keep moving onwards in our service. So if we give that up thinking, oh, I want to be just in the mode of goodness. But the mind that is in the mode of passion, it will take us in the opposite direction. If we are not doing much for Krishna, then if somebody else is doing a lot for Krishna, then the same mind will say, just see, this person getting so much praise, this person getting so much glorification. And then, you see, we will become envious of that person. And then on top of that, so somebody, this devotee sings so nicely. Somebody else, and we will say, have you seen how much he eats? So, some way we will try to undermine that devotee. Find some fault. Don't think he's such a great devotee. Right? He has problems also. You should see the problems also. Have a balanced view of things. So actually, if we want peace, in bhakti, we have to look at, I talked about one level of peace is through external situation. The other is by removing the source of agitation within us. That is better. But even a higher level is that the peace that comes by the conviction that Krishna is ultimately in control. Suhrudam sarva bhutanam gyatva mam shanti mrichyati. That Krishna is the well-wisher of everyone and Krishna will bring good out of whatever bad may happen. That conviction, the peace that comes, that is the highest peace. So this is the peace that Arjuna was experiencing even in the midst of the war. War is the opposite of peace. But Arjuna's peace was, he was completely convinced that Krishna is my benefactor and if I do Krishna's will, that is supremely auspicious for me. So even if Krishna's will puts me in a situation that is the opposite of peace, still I am ready to accept that. So Prahlad Maharaj, he had this conviction that Vishnu is the well-wisher of everyone. He is my Lord. Some of his answers, when Hiranyakashipu asks him, what have you learned in school? Or his Shandamarka asks him, you know, where did you learn all this? So some of his answers can seem just impudent. When he's asked by his father, what is the best thing you have learned in school? And he replies that actually, the best thing I have learned is that I should just renounce everything materialistic and devote yourself to Vishnu. Now for his father, the first part was still unbearable. How can you renounce everything? His whole work was to gain more and more. And the second part was unbearable. He says, devote everything to Vishnu. He wanted everything from Vishnu. How dare you speak like this? It was just outrageous. Then on top of that, when again he asked later in the final encounter, he says, you think Hiranyakashipu has tried to assassinate Prahlad in various ways and Prahlad has survived through it all. And then Hiranyakashipu is exasperated. He asks, what is the source of your strength? And now Prahlad's answer can seem very cheeky. Now cheeky, he says, you know, like childishly arrogant. He says that, you know, the source of my strength is the same as the source of your strength. In fact, the source of my strength is the same as the source of your strength. The source of your strength is Brahma. He has given you benediction. But the source of my strength is the source of your strength and the source of your strength also. And that is Vishnu. It's like saying, you ask somebody, where did you get so much money from? That person is very proud of their money. He says, my money comes from the same place from where your money comes from. That means you are telling him your money is not your money also. Don't be proud. So, why does he speak like this? You see, in Hindi there is a saying, Abel mujhe mar. It's like you provoke the other person. I was searching for some English equivalent of this, but there is nothing literally like that. It may be, we can say that you show a red cloth to a mad bull. But you can't literally translate, come bull, hit me. It doesn't make any sense. Some of these sayings which we have, we translate them from one language to another. There's a Hindi saying, Lato ke bhoot baato se nahi maante. So you translate it to English, the ghosts of kicks don't learn by words. It just doesn't make any sense. So anyway, he seems to be provoking Hiranyakashipu. So actually, Prahlad was not being cheeky or insolent. So Hiranyakashipu had this competitive vision of God. He said thought there is a hierarchy of powers. See, I am this powerful. Okay, Brahma is this powerful. Beyond him is Vishnu. If I just gain more power, then one day I will become Vishnu. So he was telling him that God is not the best of all beings. God is the basis of all being. God is not the best of all beings. That is like, you say, if you have a tennis tournament, then there is a 10th ranked player, 9th ranked player, and the number one player. So they are all players, but he is the number one player. So Krishna is not the best of all beings. Of course, he is definitely the best, but he is not in the hierarchy itself at all. Because everybody who has whatever qualities they have, they all come from Krishna. So, Brahma's qualities come from Krishna, your quality, my quality, everybody's qualities, they all come from Krishna. So, Krishna is the basis of all being. Of course, sometimes for analytical purposes, we may say, okay, Krishna is the best of all being. Krishna has 64 qualities and Vishnu has 60 qualities and then Shiva has 55 qualities, Brahma has 50 qualities. We can do some kind of analysis like that. But then the Bhagavatam is clear that Krishna's qualities are unlimited, they are not just 64. For a particular analytical frame, we may say there are 64 qualities. But the Bhagavatam says that Krishna's qualities are innumerable. Somebody might succeed in counting all the atoms in the universe, but they cannot count Krishna's qualities. So, Prahlad was not being cheeky. He was just being factual. And he was trying to help Hiranyakashipu to get out of this competitive mentality. Don't think that God is your competitor. Don't think of yourself as God's competitor also. God is your supreme benefactor. And he's just trying to convey this to Prahlad. Now, to Hiranyakashipu. Now, after Narasimhadev appears and delivers Hiranyakashipu. Narasimhadev was half man, half lion, and full God. He had all the power of God within him. And Hiranyakashipu was completely overpowered. And after that, when Hiranyakashipu is taken on his lap by Narasimhadev and his open stomach surgery is done. So at that time, there is a Vaishnava commentator Vamshidhar who writes that actually the whole question is in the beginning, is God equal to everyone? So he says that sometimes God appears and he kills the demons and he favors the devoted. So is he equal to everyone? And the seventh chapter of the Bhagavad is answering that question. So he says God is equal to everyone. But his equality is based not on neutrality, but on reciprocity. This is my words. What I mean by this is that if there is this pole, mic stand is there. Now if somebody might pat it affectionately, somebody might punch it angrily. This is neutral. It doesn't feel anything. So God's equality is not like stone-like neutrality. God is a person, and as a person, his equality is his equal reciprocity. As we approach him, so he reciprocates. So those who love him, he loves them back much more. When Prabhupada was asked once, do you love all your disciples equally? Prabhupada said, yes. And then Prabhupada added, but if someone comes forward to serve, to take responsibility, I reciprocate. So the idea is that Krishna's equality is his reciprocity. So he's equal to everyone, but based on the disposition with which people approach him, he reciprocates. So Vamshidhar writes in his commentary that how is Narasimhadev equal to both Hiranyakashipu and Prahlad in this pastime? So he says, Prahlad, after the whole pastime is getting over, Hiranyakashipu seats Prahlad on his laps. Narasimhadev seats Prahlad on his lap. And towards the end of Hiranyakashipu's life, he gets Hiranyakashipu also on his lap. So both of them get the lap of Vishnu. In this way, Vishnu is equal to both. But although both of them get the lap of Vishnu, what happens on the lap is very different. And that is dependent on their disposition. So Krishna is equal to all, but his equality is reciprocity. He reciprocates equally to everyone. So now, after this whole pastime gets over, then the various devatas come and offer prayers. And Indra offers a prayer. He says that this Hiranyakashipu, he had filled our minds with terror. And our minds were filled with fear of him, so we couldn't worship you peacefully. Now that you have eliminated him, we will resume our worship of you. And then, at that time, the devatas, Hiranyakashipu, Narasimhadev remains angry. And then Prahlad comes over there. Now, the Acharyas explain why is the Lord not pacified by the Devata's prayers? At one level, he wants to demonstrate, the pastime is demonstrating how great Prahlad's devotion is. That even what the Devatas could not do, son of a Danava was able to do, was able to pacify the Lord. But along with that, the Lord is angry with them. He said, when my devotee Prahlad was being persecuted, you neither protected him, nor did you protest against it. So at that time, you neither protected nor protested, and now you are praising me. This is just flattery. I don't care for you. So his not getting pleased with the devatas is also an expression of his affection for Prahlad. But when finally Prahlad offers prayers, there is no prayer in his, where he says, oh, this Hiranyakashipu had filled my heart with fear. Like Indra offers prayer. He says, my dear Lord, he prays to Prahlad, Prahlad prays to Narasimhadev, that my dear Lord, my only fear is the fear of material existence. Trastosmiham krupanavatsala dussogra samsara chakra kadanad grasatam pranita baddhasva karma bhirya ushatam te angrimoolam preeto apavarga sharanam vayase kadanum. He said, my dear Lord, this material existence is so fearful. I ask you, beg from you, when will you take me out of this material existence? So he has no fear of the great dangers that Hiranyakashipu posed for him, because his focus was on Krishna. The dangers of this world can take away things related with the body or things related with the mind, but the dangers of the world can't touch the soul. And the soul's relationship with Krishna, the world cannot touch that unless we get tempted or we get deluded. So the purpose of devotion for Prahlad or simply absorption in Vishnu. And that's why when Hiranyakashipu tells him, please ask for some blessings. So now most people, they go to God and ask, please give me some blessings. But here God is asking, please ask for some blessings. And then Prahlad finally says, Yadi dasyasi me kaman varamstvam varadarshibha kamanam hridaya samroham bhavatastrune varam. He says, my dear Lord, if at all you want to give me any blessing, I only want one blessing. I want my heart to be free from the desire to ask for any blessings. So he says, I serve you because I love you. I don't want anything else from you. So when we are practicing bhakti, at that time when we face obstacles, at that time we have to see, okay, I'm doing this bhakti and why are so many obstacles coming in my life? So we can see that is an opportunity Krishna is providing for purifying our devotion. Purifying our devotion means what? That if we are practicing bhakti so that we can get something from our bhakti, that is an impure motive. Of course, we want to offer things to Krishna, but the most important thing that we want to offer to Krishna is we ourselves. And sometimes we may get so caught, Krishna, I want to offer this, I want to distribute 1,000 books for you. And we get so caught in trying to offer those 1,000 books that when we are not able to offer those 1,000 books, we get so agitated, we feel my life is useless. My devotion is useless. The purpose of offering those 1,000 books is so that we can offer our consciousness to Krishna. Now in devotion we set targets, not so much to meet those targets as to meet ourselves through those targets. Meet ourselves means we bring out our real self. We offer ourselves to Krishna. So targets are meant to inspire us to bring out our best and offer it to Krishna. And when we face any kind of obstacle, whether it is relational, emotional, physical, financial, at that time we may feel that what is the point of practicing bhakti? But the point of practicing bhakti is that actually these things are important in a functional way in this world. But ultimately what matters is Krishna only. So let me shift my vision from the things of this world to Krishna. This is a subtle point. See, we are here, the world is here. And often when we face what is the problem we feel is this issue is the problem. And sometimes if you feel, by doing my service to Krishna only, this problem is coming up. So then if I just give up my service, the problem will go away. But instead of thinking like this, we want some external to be changed, but Krishna wants some internal to be changed. So what is that internal? Maybe we have to develop more humility, more purity, more intensity in our devotion. Sometimes if we have to do a service in which we are not getting any result of the service, then that we can see as an opportunity to practice unmotivated devotional service. To practice unmotivated devotional service. What am I going to get out of this? As long as we are thinking of that, then even if it is subtle, even if it is devotional, then you had to see that actually we are doing this for Krishna. And when we focus on that attitude, that I am doing this for Krishna, then we will see that Krishna observes my endeavor. Krishna sees us inside out, the world sees us outside in. So Krishna sees us inside out. That means from the worldly perspective, by his devotion, Prahlad was losing everything. But what did Prahlad see? That I am able to connect with Krishna. I am able to offer myself to Krishna. And that's why we just focus on that priority. Now, having said that, when we make Krishna our priority, how do we practically act in our life? That is also very important. When we are trying to do some service, and our service itself, in our service we face some obstacles. There is that well-known prayer which Kunti Maharani offers, where she says that, my dear Lord, that let more calamities come. Now, for one of my friends, whenever he speaks this prayer in his class, he says, there's a disclaimer. I am not offering this prayer. I am simply quoting the prayer. I have enough problem. So the prayer is that Kunti Maharani is praying, let more problems come in my life, because when those problems come, I take shelter of you, I remember you. So we already feel that I have enough problems in my life, I don't want more problems. Actually speaking, just trying to practice bhakti in Kali Yuga, and especially trying to share bhakti in Kali Yuga, it is like saying this prayer itself. Because the whole tenor, the direction of the world is opposite. And that to practice bhakti means we will face challenges. So when this happens, when our very service seems to be creating problems for us, our very bhakti seems to be creating problems for us, whether it is in our family, in our job, or even our service in our temple or our community, then at that time, we have to see, how do I move forwards? So broadly speaking, whenever we face any unpalatable situation in our life, we have three options. I call them as tolerate, mitigate, or emigrate. So, if say we come to a place where the weather is very cold, and then if the cold is very difficult to bear, we can either say, learn to tolerate, this is the place where I'm staying, so tolerate it. Otherwise, mitigate. Now, have warm clothes, have good heating in the car, in the home, and mitigate it. Or, I just can't bear this, I have to go somewhere else, we emigrate. Now, all three are valid approaches. All three can be done in a mood of service to Krishna. So, for example, the Pandavas, if we see initially when Duryodhana tried to poison Bhima, at that time Bhima survived and he came back and told Yudhishthir. Yudhishthir said, this is just a family matter, let's not make it big, let's keep it undercover and we will just be more alert. Even when they tried to burn the Pandavas alive, the Pandavas came back afterwards, they did not make an issue of it at all. So they tolerated. Now, tolerance is a very important virtue. But there are also limits to tolerance. When the Kauravas dishonored Draupadi, when the Pandavas, even after coming back from the forest, the Kauravas showed no sign of remorse or reconciliation, then the Pandavas decided to mitigate. They fought a war not to take revenge against the Kauravas, but to re-establish dharma. And eventually, when Krishna departed from the world, the Pandavas immigrated. They also renounced the world. So if you look at Srila Prabhupada's life also, there are times when he tolerated. When he was in America, first he came to Butler, Pennsylvania. He was staying at Gopal and Sally Agarwal's house. And at that time, in the same fridge where he was cooking his bhoga for Krishna, there was meat and all kinds of other foods. So for a person who has never eaten any kind of things like this, you know, it was quite an unbearable thing for him. But he tolerated it. Prabhupada, when she asked him, she knew that sadhus don't eat meat. She said, I'm sorry about it. Prabhupada said, don't think much about it. He tolerated it. But then, when he was working for building a temple for Krishna in Juhu, and the owner of that land, he had taken the money and he was not ready to give the land. He was trying to defraud the devotees. And Prabhupada said, he said, I'll not let this person steal Krishna's money away. Prabhupada fought for it. He did not tolerate at that time, he mitigated. Similarly, when Prabhupada was in India, even before that, he had been trying to share Krishna Bhakti in India for 30-40 years. But Indians were religious, but they didn't seem to be interested in becoming committed spiritual people. So then Prabhupada came to America. He emigrated. So all three can be approaches which we can use in our service to Krishna. The important thing is, underlying all these three has to be a service attitude. Krishna, how best can I serve Krishna, you? So tolerate means that when some problem is there, okay, just manage it, tolerate it. If we consider these two approaches, tolerate on one side, which is more or less changing ourselves internally. Mitigate and immigrate is change the situation or go away from that situation. So generally, Eastern cultures, they focus on the tolerate kind of approach. Just deal with it, live with it, just tolerate it. The Western cultures, they focus more on change things, just change it. Now both of them have their advantages and disadvantages. The advantage of tolerating is that we can, if somebody has the ethos of tolerating, they can persevere and commit for long term things. The disadvantage of tolerating is that sometimes become subjected to abuse, to violence, and that's how atrocious rulers can rule for a long time, and there can be exploitation. But if somebody just can't tolerate at all, then they can't commit for anything. They can't stick to anything. One reason why relationships are not stable is because people's tolerance capacity has gone down enormously. People have this utopian idea of how my life should be, and when life doesn't work out to be like that, then just change it all, give it up. So now, when do we decide, how do we decide when to tolerate, when to mitigate, or when to immigrate? So healthy balance is that we underlie it all with a service attitude to Krishna. We have, Krishna, you are my Lord, I am your servant. How can I serve you best in this situation? Now, tolerance means to keep small things small so that we can focus on the big things. Tolerance means we keep small things small so that we can focus on the big things. Say, suppose we are in a local train in India. The train has a capacity of 50 and there are 250 people in it. And everybody is squeezed together. And say some people, in every situation, there are some people who are like bullies. And say we are standing and the person next to us starts pushing us. We assert their power and position, start pushing us. We get angry. You think you are strong? I am also strong. And we push them back. And they push us back. And we push them back. And we get so caught in pushing each other that our station comes and goes and we are still pushing. Now, that is pointless, isn't it? So, okay, if you're pushing me, it's just a short journey, half an hour, 1 hour, I'll just stand somewhere else. So here the big thing is to get to our destination. The small thing is where I stand. So tolerance means to keep small things small so that you can focus on the big things. However, if that person is not just pushing us, if that person starts pushing us out of the train itself, then we can't tolerate. Because then their action is coming in the way of the big thing for us. The big thing is that we want to move to, we want to get to our destination. So it is purpose that brings perspective. It is purpose that brings perspective. Perspective means what is the big thing, what is the small thing. Srila Prabhupada writes in the 10th chapter Bhagavad Gita purport that intelligence means to see things in their proper perspective. This is more important, this is less important. So for a more important thing, I'm ready to challenge. I'm ready to tolerate a less important thing. This is an inconvenience, but if I can do that, then I'm ready to tolerate this for that sake. So many times in today's materialistic world, most people don't have any big purpose in their life. So what happens if we don't have anything really big in our life? Then every small thing becomes big. If we don't have something big in our life. Say, if we are going for some important meeting and then somebody cuts us across the road, we'll be annoyed, but okay, just forget and move on. If you're just driving for fun, if you just got a brand new car and we want everyone to see what a nice car I've got, and then somebody cuts across, how dare you cut across me? So what happens, if there is no big thing in our life, then every small thing can become big. So those who have nothing to fight for in life will fight for anything. It's not that they will stop fighting. Those who have nothing really important in their life which they have to fight for, then the Rajoguna is there, so they will pick up any small thing and fight over that. That's why for us, if we understand, I am Krishna's servant and I am meant to serve Krishna. So all my activities are meant to be in a mood of service to Krishna. So sometimes we are doing some service and say we are facing some trouble from because of that. But the service is so important that I am ready to tolerate this trouble. So tolerance means we can keep small things small and focus on the big thing. That's okay. But sometimes it may happen that our big thing itself is interrupted. If our big thing itself is interrupted, then we have to move on. Then we either have to mitigate or we have to emigrate. Mitigate means we have to take some action so that we have our space for doing service to Krishna. And so if we are doing some surveys and we find that we are having this problem, that problem, that problem, then we may have to talk with the necessary authorities and try to get those facilities so that we can do that service. So mitigation means trying to create some external change. Now if we tolerate, then the external change will not be there, but we may still be able to do something important. But if we try to mitigate and it doesn't seem to work, we're trying, it's just becoming more complicated, then we may decide that, you know, I have better things to do in my life. I have better ways to serve Krishna, so I don't want to get involved in this. We may just choose to immigrate. Immigrate means that we may go to somewhere else and do some other service. Not necessarily physically relocate somewhere else. We may decide, I want to do some other service. Now, each of these can be done with a service attitude, and each of those can be done with a resentful attitude. If we are tolerating with a resentful attitude, then what is going to happen? All that resentment is going to get accumulated within us. And then one day, boom! It'll be like a... Sometimes in some relationships, you know, there are some small noises that come. But sometimes some relationship appears to be noiseless for one long time, and then one explosion, everything has disappeared. So, if the tolerance is not based on transcendence, if the tolerance is based on suppression, then the tolerance cannot last for long. I was with a devotee who is a marriage counselor, and he was telling me, in his observation, there are only two kinds of couples. He says, those who quarrel with each other and those whom you don't know very well. So, his point was that, actually, that idea that there will be no differences when two people live together, that is never going to happen. There will be differences. All that they can do is find out proper means to deal with those differences. So, if we learn to, if we are tolerating based on suppressing, it won't last for long. But if we are tolerating based on some higher purpose, then when that higher purpose is fulfilled, that fulfillment makes the tolerance worthwhile. So, tolerance can be done with a negative attitude or with a positive attitude. Similarly, with respect to mitigation. Now, we can mitigate just to set the things right by which we can do our service. Or we can mitigate with a vendetta towards other person. You did like this to me, just see now what I am going to do to you. When that becomes the motive, then you know, we just lose track. In bhakti, our purpose is not to get even. Our purpose is to get out. Isn't it? It's not get even. You did like this to me, so I'll do like this to you. No, our purpose is to get out of this world ultimately. To rise above material consciousness. So, we don't have time to get even with others. The Pandavas did not fight a war to take revenge against the Kauravas. They fought so that they could do their service to Krishna. They could establish Dharma. When Srila Prabhupada was fighting for this Juhu land, so there was the owner, Mr. N, who was using gundas to threaten the devotees, who was doing all kinds of terrible things. And then he passed away and his wife took up the battle. And then she started making things worse. But then her whole moves backfired against her, and then eventually she decided to come to meet Prabhupada and make an agreement. And when she met Prabhupada, she saw Prabhupada's saintliness. You know, she fell at Prabhupada's feet and begged forgiveness. And Prabhupada was so gentle and kind. He says, you're just like my daughter. I'll take care of you. So although Prabhupada was fighting for getting that temple and she was the person who was stopping her, Prabhupada had no negative feelings towards her. He said, so there was no, he was not fighting against her. He was fighting for Krishna. He was not fighting against Mr. N or Mrs. N. He was fighting for Krishna. And once he got the temple, he had no animosity towards anyone. So when we say forget and forgive, what it means is there's no delete button in our brain by which you can forget. If somebody has done something wrong, we can't delete it from our minds. But when we say forget and forgive, what it simply means is just move ahead with life. Don't be stuck with what everybody has done. We all have made some mistakes in our life. Others have made mistakes in their lives. So just move on. So even if you have to mitigate something, the purpose has to be clear. Purpose is, I simply want to clear my path for that I can serve Krishna. I don't have to get back at someone, even if they have troubled me. So then, immigrate would mean that, okay, I want to do a different service to Krishna. Let me just move on in my life. And this service is not working out, I want to do some other service. That's also okay. But when we mitigate, when we immigrate, we are walking away. And walking away is different from running away. When we run away from something, our mind is still there. Oh, this situation is so terrible, this person is so bad, nobody helps me in that situation, I have to run away from here. So we go away, but our mind is still caught over there. Whereas walk away means that we just move on in my life. Okay, this is not, I can't tolerate this, I can't mitigate this, so I'll just do some other service to Krishna. The world is a big place and we all can find our space in which to serve Krishna. So all these three approaches are fine. So when we find that our service is leading to some difficulty for us, then we may decide that I can choose any of these options. So say if somebody is in a country where you cannot practice bhakti publicly, in the Middle East or in China, for example, then they may decide to tolerate. Okay, my whole life is here, my career is, I'll tolerate, I'll practice bhakti here. They may try to mitigate, they may try to work to get the political laws changed, pass some resolutions so that devotees are also recognized and allowed to practice. Or they may decide, I don't want to get involved in this, I just want to practice my bhakti, I'll emigrate. So all three attitudes are fine, provided they are done with a service attitude. So bhakti is not only about tolerating, nor is it only about mitigating, nor is it only about emigrating. It is about serving Krishna. And however we can serve Krishna, we do that. So with respect to Prahlad, he just tolerated it all. For him, because his consciousness was so absorbed in Krishna, even when somebody attacked him, somebody tried to kill him, when the snakes came to bite him, his vision was, oh, this snake is actually the Sheshanag of Vishnu. And seeing that snake which was coming to kill him, it intensified his remembrance of Vishnu. And he became absorbed in Vishnu. Like that, wherever he was put, he just kept remembering Krishna and he tolerated everything. So of course, Prahlad is also a 5-year-old boy. What can he do against his father? But Arjuna, after hearing the Bhagavad Gita, he mitigated. He fought a war. So at different times, different things may be, approaches may be required for dealing with the situation that we are in. The important thing is that we keep serving Krishna. So we need some external facility to serve Krishna, and we need some internal facility in terms of peace of mind or clarity of thought or just some space by which we can serve Krishna. So creating that is our responsibility. How do we create that? That's up to us. So when we learn to find that space in which we can serve Krishna, we'll find that we'll march ahead in our service. It is Krishna who is watching. No matter what situation we are in, Krishna is always watching us. And Krishna is waiting for us. Wherever we go, Krishna is there with us. And I'll conclude with a prayer from Kulashekhar Maharaj. He says, Ma bhir manda mano vichinte bahudhaya mischiram yatana naivami prabhavanti paparipava swami nanu shridharaha Alasyam vyapaniya bhakti sulabham dhyayasva narayanam lokasya vyasanapano dankaro dasyasya kim nakshamaha. So when we face too many problems in our life, we feel, is this bhakti helping me at all? What is the use of practicing bhakti? He says that don't think like this. Even people who are not devoted to Krishna, they just come for utilitarian purposes to Krishna. They just have some problem, that's why they come to Krishna and they pray. And even Krishna helps them. Lokasya vasana panodan karo. If people were not getting something about their worship, why would they go to God at all? So even ordinary people who come with largely self-centered motives, Krishna helps them also. So dasyasya kim nakshama. So if somebody has dedicated their life to serving Krishna, why will Krishna not help them? And he says, naivami prabhavanti paparipava swami nanu shridharaha. You say, oh, actually I have done many wrongs in the past and what I am suffering is my own karma. That is true, but it may be true, but what he says is, remember that your Lord is paparipavaha. He is the enemy of all sins and he is shridharaha. He is the Lord of the goddess of fortune. And therefore, he can remove all misfortune from your life. Then, why is there misfortune in a devotee's life? It's only because of one thing. Alasyam vyapaniya bhakti sulabham dhyayasvanarayanam. He says, the only misfortune in a devotee's life is that the devotee is lazy to remember Krishna. Just give up this laziness, wholeheartedly remember Krishna. We tell people, the only problem in the world is a lack of Krishna consciousness. But the only problem in my life is this devotee is troubling me. How does it work like that? So, philosophically we are very, only problem in the world is a lack of Krishna consciousness. Well then, the only problem in my life should also be lack of Krishna consciousness. Now, when we become Krishna conscious, what does that mean? That means we may have to deal with the situation practically also. But first, we focus on becoming Krishna conscious. And then, okay, how do I deal with the situation? That there is an external situation which needs to be rectified. We can rectify it. But first, rectify ourselves internally. Krishna, whatever happens, I don't want to be the controller. I want to be the servant. Please guide me how I can serve you in this situation. So once we do this, alasyam vipaniya bhakti sulabham dayasvanarayanam. Just give up lethargy. Bhakti is easy to practice. Just practice bhakti. Look, then what will happen by that? We'll find that Krishna is always with us. Sometimes we feel Krishna is far away. I am facing so many problems. Is Krishna helping me? Actually, how far away is Krishna from us? Bhakti sulabham. Bhakti is very easy. That means Krishna is just one thought away from us. We just have to think about him. If we think devotedly about him, we can feel his presence. And that presence will bring calm in our life. That remembrance can bring calm. That can bring clarity. That can provide solace. That can provide strength to us. So when we just understand, Krishna, you are my Lord. I am your servant. I want to serve you. When we have this attitude, then Krishna will guide us. Whatever situations may come in our life, Krishna is there with us to help us go through them and to grow through them. So, what life? Whenever problems come, it seems that bhakti is creating problems. It's not that bhakti is creating problems. It is rather that problem is making us intensify our bhakti, deepen our remembrance of Krishna. So, for Prahlad Maharaj, it was he transformed the intensity of the distress into velocity in his devotion. He transformed the intensity of his distress. The more Hiranyakashipu persecuted him, the more strongly he became devoted to Vishnu. And as his devotion became so much, that Vishnu was only one thought away from him. That Vishnu appeared. And by that dramatic appearance, he delivered Prahlad from all the troubles that he was facing. So I'll summarize. I spoke on the theme of how Krishna's power to heal is greater than life's power to hurt. And that today I spoke about how when we try to do something good, go out of our way to try to do something good, and then that creates trouble for us. How do we deal with that? So Prahlad Maharaj was so devoted, and it was because of his devotion that he was facing problems. So most people go to God because they have some physical problems. I don't have this, I don't have that. Or nowadays people go to God because they have psychological problems. I want peace of mind. Now sometimes we may not get either of these by going to God. Rather, we may seem to be losing these. So we understand, I talked about peace, which may be at three levels. One piece is by creating a peaceful situation. The second is by removing the impurities within us that take away our peace. And the third is by developing the conviction that Krishna is in control and Krishna is my well-wisher. So if peace is all that we wanted, then why would we form any relationship at all? Every relationship brings some unpredictability with it, and that unpredictability can disturb our peace. But our heart longs for something more than peace. It longs for love. And bhakti is about love. So if the practice of bhakti seems to be agitating us sometimes, the taking up service, taking up responsibility is agitating us, we see that this agitation is not because of my devotion. It is simply because I have rajoguna within me, and that if I don't take up responsibility of service which agitates my mind, then my mind will create some other agitation somewhere else. So better let me serve Krishna. So if we don't do something wonderful for Krishna, then we will become envious of those who are doing something wonderful for Krishna. So better we take up responsibility and try to serve Krishna. And for us, when obstacles come externally, we see those as impetuses to purify our devotion. And it means I am serving Krishna not to get anything from Krishna. I am serving Krishna simply for getting Krishna. Krishna's greatest blessing is Krishna himself. And when with this internal change we make that Krishna, I want only you, then the external situation that we have to deal with, we can have three approaches for it: tolerate, mitigate, or emigrate. And the tolerance means to keep small things small so that you can focus on big things. If too much tolerance is there, then that can lead to abuse and violence and negativity. On the other hand, if there is too less tolerance, then that can lead to complete lack of commitment and constant instability. So the balance is found by a service attitude. If we have a purpose, then that will provide us perspective. This is my purpose. This is the big thing in my life. And for this big thing, I can tolerate the small things. If I have to get to my destination, somebody is pushing me in my train, I'll move aside. But if somebody starts pushing me out of the train, I can't tolerate that. So when we keep that big thing in our mind, our service to Krishna in mind, then how to deal with which situation, whether through tolerating, mitigating, or emigrating, we can all do that in a proper way. If we tolerate and repress our feelings, then they will explode sometime. If we mitigate in a revengeful attitude, then we will get distracted from Krishna in seeking that revenge. Our purpose is not to get even, but to get out of the world, to get out of material consciousness. So when somebody is creating some obstacles for us, our purpose is not to get back at the person, but to get on with our service to Krishna. And when we emigrate, it's not running away from something, but it's walking away because we have some higher purpose to fulfill. And when we are going through difficulties in our life, if we understand that Krishna is not far away, Krishna is close to me, he's in my heart, he's just one thought away from me, then if we take shelter of Krishna, then there may be many problems in our life, but that remembrance of Krishna will give us inner calmness and clarity by which we can deal with whatever situations we are facing. So the biggest problem for a devotee is a lack of enthusiasm and devotion. Alasyam vepaniya bhakti sulabham dhyayasvanarayanam. If we devote ourselves to Krishna, he will enable us to go through and grow through whatever problems come our way. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Thank you. Any questions or comments? Yes, Prahlad.
Thank you so much. I have a question on this thing aspect which you said, that once we start in bhakti, there might be some impediments that come and but yeah, from our own perspective, I could understand from the explanation that you gave. But let's say I'm working with folks and somehow they are inspired to do services, but then things, because as you said, like interruptions come and things get tough. So how to keep them motivated instead of they saying, oh, I'm getting so many problems even though I'm serving, so I'm going to just keep service aside and get into my material life again and try to move forward. So how can we inspire?
Talking about others means your relatives or just anybody else?
Like friends I'm working with.
Friends, okay. So if we encourage someone to practice bhakti, but then when try to serve Krishna, they face so many obstacles, they feel, just let me forget this and practice my material life only, progress in my material lives. What do we tell them? Yes. In life, anything worthwhile requires a struggle to get. So even our service to Krishna, there is a certain amount of struggle involved in it. That's why if somebody is to practice bhakti, it's important that they get some philosophical understanding of why we are practicing bhakti. See, there is cultural devotion, there is philosophical devotion, and there is transcendental devotion. Cultural devotion means that it's not just cultural, it could be cultural, it can be social, it can be traditional. That means I practice bhakti because it's a part of my culture. I practice bhakti because it's been in our tradition. Culture means everybody else is doing it, so I'll do it. Tradition means we always done it in the past, so I should do it. Or social devotion means, oh, nice people over here, I like to be among these people, that's why I'm practicing bhakti. These all can be various starting points for our bhakti. In general, when people come to spiritual life, it's very few people who come with philosophical questions. Madhvacharya, in his commentary to Athato Brahma Jigyasa, that verse, he says, you should inquire about spirituality. He says, what is it that triggers the Brahma Jigyasa in people? Says for very few people, automatically Brahma Jigyasa is there. And in Kali Yuga, instead of Athato Brahma Jigyasa, we have Athato Bhayankar Jigyasa. So people inquire of all kinds of things. Especially among college students, in university campus they find, one of the most common searches the students have is, how to commit suicide. It's terrible. So what happens is that Athato Brahma Jigyasa, how does it come? It doesn't come automatically, very rarely. For most people, that Brahma Jigyasa comes by associating with those who are doing Brahma Jigyasa, spiritually minded people. So initially, people may come because of cultural, traditional, social reasons. So that is all fine. But after they come, if they get an opportunity to hear the philosophy and if they understand the philosophy, then the cultural, traditional, social aspects will still remain, but they will not be the primary purposes for practicing bhakti. If I am practicing bhakti because, say, I was born in a family where everybody was practicing bhakti, then tomorrow I go to a new place where nobody is practicing bhakti, see, why should I be the odd person out? Let me give up my bhakti. But if you understand the philosophy, then we'll rise from philosophical devotion to transcendental devotion. Transcendental devotion means not that we give up culture or society or tradition, but that those are not the motives for practicing bhakti. The motive for practicing bhakti is to connect with Krishna. So if we can help people to understand the philosophy, then they can persevere in their practice of bhakti. Of course, if they have come for culture or tradition or socialization, then that need also has to be fulfilled. But if somebody comes only for that, then they cannot sustain for long. Then they will stay at a level of piety. And this is a good thing which I do. I was with my brother in Detroit, so he was telling, he brought his colleague, one of his colleagues to meet me. He's telling, oh, it was Janmashtami time. So he said, I also come to temple regularly. I come to the ISKCON temple regularly. Said, how regularly? He said, every Janmashtami. So now it's good, at least Janmashtami is coming, but then that's piety, that's not spirituality at all. Just okay, you have to go do something good when it's Janmashtami. So people have to be given philosophical understanding, then they can rise to spiritual devotion. Okay,
thank you.
Any other questions? Yes, please. Okay, I'll come to you.
Yeah. Thank you for categorizing the motivations. That's really helpful to the panel. Mm-hmm. My question actually is different. With respect to Hiranya, let's say they are getting mad with the demigods. Why didn't they protect Balarama? Is it because they had Adhikar and they are supposed to protect? My question basically is coming from a different review of what a Madhyam Adhikari needs to do typically. That's not for me, I'm a Karistika, but just to expound the question. A Madhyam Adhikari has to deal with three different types of people. Someone is senior to them, equal, and junior. And within junior, there are two categories, A and B. One is just junior, but juniors who are having, he is having an Adhikar, or she is having an Adhikar. So, four types of people. Mm. So, what should people do in conjunction to what Narasimhadev is expecting from them? Because only for Adhikaris, they should have intervened, others should have been removed. If something going wrong, some injustice is happening.
Okay. So, if we see something wrong happening somewhere, like say Devata saw that Hiranyakashipu was doing terribly wrong things to Prahlad, and Lord Narasimhadev was angry because Devatas didn't do anything. So what is expected from us when we do, when we see something wrong happening? Yes, first thing is that something wrong will always be happening. If we expect that there should be an ideal society, I want a community in which I am to be ideal, then we'll be searching for the rest of eternity. There is no ideal community anywhere. And if at all we found an ideal community, we won't get admission in it. Because how many of us can claim to be ideal? So always there will be something wrong. But again, in wrongness also there are degrees of wrongness. Something may be very seriously wrong. Something may be like a trivial thing which is wrong. So generally, we have to see that, as you rightly pointed out, what is my position? And if still we feel very troubled by something, this doesn't seem to be right, then we can go and maybe seek an explanation or give a report to somebody who's in an authority position. And if that is resolved by that, that is good. If it is not resolved by that, then we have to see that, okay, I did my part, let me move on with my service. But if it's such a serious matter that it's not being solved at all, not being addressed, then we might report to somebody more senior authority. So there are two aspects to our devotion. One is that we do what is our service, and that should be our focus. And we also look at the broader community, and we also, if there's something which is going wrong, if we can be a part of the solution, then we work on that. But some people, they become like self-appointed watchdogs. The only service they do is to see what wrong everybody else is doing in their service. Then that is not very healthy. Everybody is learning, everybody is growing, everybody is a volunteer actually over here ultimately. Mm-mm. So we cannot expect professionalism when we are all practicing bhakti. We try to do as well as we can. So those who are gossipers, you know, that which is none of their business, talking about it, they make it their business. Oh, you know, this person did like this. So if we can go through authorized channels and try to explain things, try to report things, sometimes it may be that things are not wrong, but we just have got a wrong perspective of them. Sometimes things may be wrong, and when we report it, they are set right. Sometimes things are wrong, but somehow they are not set right. Then we have to make sure that, okay, if this is disturbing me too much, and I have done my part to try to set it right, and I don't have any further position or connection to do anything more, then we just focus on our service to Krishna. The important thing is that we don't let anything stop our relationship with Krishna. And as a part of our relationship, if we can do some other service also, apart from what is our main service, we can do that also. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. One question, but
can we come back to you later? Yes, please.
Thank you for the nice class. It was really nice. When Prahlad Maharaj went to Lord Nisringadev, didn't he also say, what I'd like you to do is save my father?
Yeah. Actually,
that showed such compassion that he had for his father.
That's true. Yes, actually, when I said that my only desire is that I should have no desire, I should have qualified that actually, my only desire is I should have no material desire. Then when he used the word kaman, I have no material desire. But he does say that, please deliver my father. And that actually an extraordinary level of compassion, as you pointed out, that he didn't, somebody who had been trying to torment him throughout his life, Prahlad desired his deliverance at the end of his life. It's extraordinary.
And then one other thing is that tolerance is important, but patience is also important. When you're practicing bhakti, there's a simple example that we always would try to remember as new devotees in the early 70s, that it's like cleaning a house. When you first go in, it looks really clean, but then you actually start cleaning and really it's not clean. There's dirt everywhere in all the corners and so many things. So we're practicing, we have to be patient, and that will clear because the chanting is so powerful.
Yes, thank you. Along with tolerance, we need patience to persevere in our devotion. Yes, utsaha nishaya dhairyat, we say. There's enthusiasm, there is patience, and then there is faith, conviction. So if we have enthusiasm without patience, that is rajoguna. That is more of passion. You know, I'm doing things, but I want results the next day. If I have patience without enthusiasm, that is tamoguna. If I'm just patient, I'm not doing anything at all. I don't chant, I don't practice bhakti, I'm patiently waiting for purification. If we are only waiting, then we are not worshippers, we are waiters. So, patience and enthusiasm both bring us to sattva guna, if we have both. And if patience, enthusiasm and faith, we have, that takes us to shuddha sattva. That takes us to the transcendental level. Yes. So, the enthusiasm part is for making a change, but the patience part is required for waiting, tolerating while the change is happening. Yes, thank you. Hare Krishna. Yes, please.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Yeah, welcome.
Thank you so much for such insightful lectures for the past 3 days. Really appreciate that. So my question is, as you rightly said, it depends on the disposition. It depends on moment after moment choices that you make. But it's not always, you know, very clear. I should do this or that. It's rather hazy most of the time. And apparently it looks either of the two, or it's like a multiple choice and multiple check boxes. So how do we, at least what are the principles to make the right choice?
Yeah. So when to decide whether to tolerate or mitigate or immigrate, then how do we make the right choice? Because it's not always easy to decide. Yes, say decision making is a big subject in itself, but broadly speaking, the principle in bhakti is that we try to serve Krishna with what we have right now. That means that if I think, okay, when I get this information, when I get this, when I get that, then I'll serve Krishna. We cannot wait for that. One understanding of surrender is that surrender means to do what we can with what we have now. Surrender means to do what we can with what we have now. Some devotees may say that, okay, you know, I want to give charity, but in the future, when I have more, then I will give this big amount of charity. But till then, I can't give anything. Well, okay, yes, in future you can give more, but charity is not just an activity. Charity is also a mentality. It's not so much that the act of giving charity is not just important, it is the habit of giving something to Krishna that is important. Same way with someone, I don't have time to chant now. So, you know, one spiritual master was telling me that a disciple came to him and he said that, you know, Maharaj, I have got 1800 rounds pending. Now, he said, now I'm soon going to retire. When I retire, every day I'll chant 64 rounds. Well, okay, you can chant 64 rounds, but chant now also. So what happens is, sometimes we just actually think that in this situation, I don't know, so I'll not do anything. But surrender means we have to do what we can with what we have now. In future, if we have more, we'll do more. But we have to do what we can now. So, that means that with whatever knowledge we have, okay, I analyze this factor point to this, then I make a decision based on that. The best understanding that we can get, we consult some senior devotees, we get some guidance. Broadly speaking, if we go through a proper process of deliberation, that means it's good if it's a major decision to write something down, write things down, all the factors down, and then analyze them. We pray over them, again do a reanalysis. Then as we keep thinking about things, other things may emerge. We may decide a finite amount of time I will give. Maybe I'll spend next 1 month on making this decision. And then at the start of the month, I just write down all the factors involved. And then I may decide that what happens if you have to make a major decision, if you're constantly thinking about it, it simply drains our energy. It doesn't go anywhere. So you may write everything down that we know and then decide that every week I may spend half an hour, 1 hour, I'll pray before it, I'll try to come to the mode of goodness and then analyze it more. Is there something, some more factor that I have not considered? Then what happens when we write everything down tangibly, it's like we take a snapshot of our mind and then we get it out. And then after 1 week, we say, okay, you know, this thing I did not realize, this is also important. After some time, we say, okay, this is also important. Overall, after one month, we have prayerfully contemplated it, then we come to a decision, then it won't be just an impulsive thing. We have thought deeply about it. And if it's a bigger thing, we might spend a little more time on it. But that way, constantly thinking about a decision doesn't help in solving the decision. But not thinking about the decision also doesn't help. So we have to think in a disciplined way. And that means create some time, create some sattva guna, and then think about it. And the Mahabharata says that right and wrong action, how do we decide that? Right and wrong decision, how do we decide that? Broadly three factors. There's intent, content, and consequence. What am I doing? Why am I doing it? And what is the result of doing it? So some actions, broadly speaking, we can understand this is right, this is wrong. What am I doing? But sometimes that which may normally be wrong may be right in a particular situation. Say, Sanatana Goswami, when he was imprisoned for no fault of his by the Nawab Hussein Shah, then he had to speak counterfactual things. He said, I want to go to Mecca, so please release me. For him, his Mecca was Vrindavan. You know, that was what he had in mind. But he spoke what was required, so the intent was right. From the content point of view, to speak something which is counterfactual is not right. But the intent was right. He wanted to surrender to Krishna. Sometimes the intent may be right, the content may be right, but we have not considered some other factors and the consequence turns out to be wrong. So if the consequence turns out to be undesirable, then we understand, okay, that action was not the right action to take. Then as soon as we realize that, we do some course correction as much as we can and we move on. So we can't wait, we can't postpone our service till we make the right decision. We have to do our service, and we can see decision making also as an act of service. That means with the information I have, with the intelligence I have, with the guidance I have right now, I make this decision in a mood of service to you. And then we learn from that. So if we learn from it, we will grow by that also. Okay, this experience. The Bhagavad Gita was simply meant to give Arjuna a decision. Krishna could have just spoken one word, fight, yuddhasva. But the whole purpose of the Bhagavad Gita was not just to give Arjuna a decision. It was to equip Arjuna with the philosophical context by which decisions are made. So that even if Krishna is not there, this philosophical worldview with him, and based on that worldview, he can make his own decisions. That's why we don't have to postpone our service till we make a decision. We make some decision as in a mood of service, and based on how it works out, we move onwards or make course correction. Does that answer your question? Yes.
So as we are discussing about the Prahlad Maharaj's commentary, so I have a question. So if you step back a little bit from Bhagavatam to Puranas about Prahlad Maharaj's prayers in Narasimha Kavacha Sutra, he says that, you know, the one verse, the Putravan Dhanavan Lokitirthaya Vijaya Niyam Yam Kavaya Dev. So that means if Prahlad Maharaj is petitioning Lord Narasimha Dev, that I don't need any desire, But on the other hand, if you see, he's saying, I need sun,
okay.
I need dhan, I need the dhaya, yam and kamayati, whatever desires I have, let my Lord yesterday, Narasimhadev, fulfill it. So how
okay.
do we see this kind of...
Okay, good question. So in Narasimha Kavacha Stotra, we have the Narasimha Kavacha Mantra, which ends with Putravan Dhanavan Loki, that we get children, get wealth, get position, so many things like that, get health, get long life. So the two things over here. In general, the Phalashruti in many prayers is not necessarily composed by the original composer. The Phalashruti is often added on later. If we consider the Vishnu Sahasranam, the Sahasranam is 1,000 names. But there are so many verses which are there as the Phalashruti. Now if you look at the Vishnu Sahasranam that is there in the Mahabharata, Bhishma spoke it to Yudhishthir, there are other places also it is there. There that particular Phalashruti may not be there. So we don't have to be necessarily think that the Phalashruti has come from the original composer himself. Now this Narasimha Kavacha Stotra, I think it is from the Brahmanda Puran, if I am not mistaken. So in general, most of the Puranas don't talk about pure devotion. They talk about devotion which is mixed. That means, yes, we want God, but we also want the blessings of God in this world. And it is not wrong to seek those things. Right and wrong is a matter of context. Say if a parent has 2 children and one of them is a very good student, say out of 100% that child gets 90%, and there's another child who just squeaks through, he gets only 40%, and say both of them come with the results and both of them have got 65%. So now for the 40% child, the parents say, well done, well done, they'll pat him on the back. And for the child who has got 90%, who used to get 90%, got 60%, what have you done? Isn't it? I say, both of us got the same marks. Why the different reaction? Because they are coming from different positions. So for people who are godless, who are materialistic, for them, the main reason why they'll come to God is because they want to get something from God. So scripture contains that kind of religion also. In fact, that is the majority of religion, that's karma kanda. So for most people to rise from godlessness to what Bhaktivinoda Thakur calls it as, from godless materialism to pious materialism. They're materialist, but they're religiously materialistic. That is also a step forward. That is like from 40% to 65%. But on the other hand, somebody who's at the level of pure devotion, if they start practicing materialistic devotion, then that is coming down from 90% to 65%. So the Bhagavatam is depicting devotion at the 90% level. The other scriptures depict devotion at a lower level. And Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur in his comment, similar section in the 4th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, where it is described that Prithu Maharaj was performing yajnas, and in that yajnas he was also worshipping the various devatas. And Chakravarti Pada raises the question, how can a devotee worship the devatas? But he says that he saw that most of his citizens were at the level where they could only worship devatas. They couldn't practice pure devotion. So to set an example for them, externally he was chanting the mantras for the devatas, but internally he was seeing those devatas as Narayana Angaja, as parts of Narayana, and he was worshipping them in that mode. That means, when we practice bhakti, we have to see that what is the level that is the best for us. And if somebody else is practicing bhakti, what is the level that is good for them? So, if somebody chants Narasimha Kavach Mantra and that's what starts helping them to develop some faith in Krishna, some reason to approach the Lord, that is good for them. But when we devotees chant, then we may not chant with those particular motives. So, if that is the kind of Phalashruti that is there, I know some devotees who start chant Narasimha Kavach, but they don't chant that Phalashruti, because that's not the fal that we are looking for. Or we can chant that Phalashruti as just a matter of deference to tradition. But that is not, we don't invest our desires over there. So we don't have to think that everything in scripture has to match with Krishna consciousness. But you see, the Prabhupada has not given us just scriptural wisdom. He has given us the best of scriptural wisdom. Scriptural wisdom is, there is a lot in scripture. In scripture there are things for sattvaguni people, there are things for rajoguni people, there are things for tamoguni people. If you start looking all over scripture and try, if we want scriptural support for Krishna consciousness, there is abundant scriptural support. But if you are looking for 100% scriptural agreement with Krishna consciousness, we will not find that. Because scripture is multi-level. There are scriptural sections we will talk about, sub-religious principles also. But there are the highest religious principles which are also talked about. So we focus on that section of scripture which focuses on the highest religious principles. And we practice those. While we recognize that other religious principles are also valuable for people at different levels. Okay? Thank you. Yes?
Thank you, Mr. Prabhu. And I like the point you gave that God is equal to everyone. Yeah, somebody hits the mic, it's hard, low, and somebody hits low, like soft, low.
Yeah.
The pain you get, it depends on how hard you hit. So it's not that God like making you feel pain. It's in the real life, it's like how you condition in this material world, right? The more you condition in this world, the more you will feel pain.
Correct,
so
yeah.
It's not a God is making you feel pain.
Correct. That's true, yeah.
Yeah, and the question I have is like, if you become a pure devotee,
you know, yeah.
Okay. So if you become pure devotee, you will still be bothered by the dualities like anxiety, happiness, because Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, if you become real yogi, you will be conquering all the dualities. So getting anxiety, anger, is it the sign of like pure devotion? Like,
okay, good question. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that we conquer over all dualities when we become pure devotees. Then will we still have anxiety or anger? There are two different things over here. One is, there are material dualities which a devotee transcends. Now what do we exactly mean by a devotee transcends material dualities? Say for example, there is heat and cold. So is it that if there is a pure devotee, that pure devotee will not feel heat or cold? No, there is a body and the body has its own features. So a devotee, if the body has its own functionality and the body will work according to its laws. So naturally, if there is, it's very hot or very cold, even a pure devotee will feel that. To spiritualize ourselves is not to depersonalize ourselves. We are still persons. So what does it mean a devotee transcends duality? That means the devotee's devotion transcends the dualities. That means if the service of Krishna requires somebody to go to a freezingly cold place, if the service requires one to tolerate dishonor, a devotee will tolerate dishonor also. So that means we can look at these as these dualities as externals coming upon us. They can be physical externals like heat or cold. They can be happiness or distress. They can be honor, dishonor. All these are externals which come upon us. So for most of us, if the externals are unfavorable, we just stop practicing bhakti. It's like say, if we are going on a bicycle and then a big tree falls in our way, then I say, hey, you stop, I can't go ahead. But if we are going in a huge truck and then a tree falls on our way, the truck's momentum will be such that the tree will be swept aside. So for us, when obstacles come in our devotion is like that cycle. The obstacle comes, our devotion stops. But for exalted devotees, their devotion is like a fast moving truck. It has such momentum that the obstacle is swept aside and they persevere. So when we say that we are there beyond dualities, that doesn't mean that they don't feel anything at the material level. It simply means that the feelings at the material level don't affect their devotional determination. They persevere in their devotion. Secondly, also that there are material emotions and there are transient. Normally we feel anxiety because something important to us is going to be is at risk. A devotee is completely absorbed in Krishna. So a devotee's anxiety is on Krishna's behalf. Now this is for Krishna, it must be done well. So when Yashoda Mai, she is cooking for Krishna, she is singing Krishna's glories, but still she is concerned that let this be done as well as I can. And in that sense, the word anxiety may have a negative connotation, But the point is that there is that intense concern. I must do things well for Krishna. So that is, so basically the emotionality is not the problem. It is the center of the emotions that is the issue. If I am the center of all my emotions, then that self-centered emotion will be the cause of our delusion. But if Krishna is the center of all our emotions, then emotion centered on Krishna will elevate and liberate us. Okay?
Okay. I mean, it's just like, it's only a verifying yourself where you are in the path of the spirit of devotion, right? You are bothered by this condition and you have to think that you are still not in the pure devotees, right?
Yeah, so if we are bothered by these conditions, then we are not, I would say, if those conditions stop us in our devotion, to feel that thing is just a biological or psychological response. If somebody insults us, we will feel bad. But is it that because this person insulted me, so I will give up my bhakti? No. Even if this person insulted me, still I will go on with my bhakti. So, we don't have to deny the physical or the psychological realities. But we don't have to reduce our consciousness to the physical and psychological realities alone. We understand our purpose is higher. We acknowledge this has happened. But we persevere. So, I put it this way that we may have to live with pain. But we don't have to live in pain. With pain means, yes, at a physical level, at a psychological level, I have pain. But my purpose is bigger. My identity is a part of someone who is far bigger. Therefore, I may have to live with pain, but I won't live in pain. Okay. Thank you. Yeah?
Thank you, Prabhu, for the nice lecture.
Yeah.
You talked about enthusiasm. Actually, when I look back in my life, I think I feel that that is missing. I don't know why, but for example, if I have to chant, get up early and chant, I'm not able to get up. But if I have to get up early to catch a flight, I am definitely able to do it. I think that enthusiasm or the passion is altogether missing. And sometimes I feel that because the devotee has all that things, I am not a devotee. I may want to become a devotee, but I don't know how to do that.
Okay. Thank you. So if you feel that we are lacking enthusiasm in our devotion, then we feel it's like we are not devotees at all. So what should we do? If you want to wake up, but you're not able to wake up in the mornings. Yes. You know, if we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, we can fail in Krishna consciousness. Not, we can fail in Krishna consciousness, not fail out of Krishna consciousness. What I mean by this is that actually Krishna consciousness is not just about adhering to some standards. As the adherence to standards is important, but even more important is the consciousness. Sometimes we may not be able to do something in our Krishna consciousness, but if that increases our sense of dependence on Krishna, sense of need for Krishna, our sense of calling out to Krishna, then that is a success. So we can fail in Krishna consciousness. So Krishna consciousness is so inclusive that failing in Krishna consciousness means that I am not able to do it, but my consciousness keeps me in Krishna consciousness. Parikshit Maharaj in one sense did something wrong. He offended a sage. He failed, but he failed in Krishna consciousness. He took that situation as an opportunity to intensify his Krishna consciousness. So if we are not able to do something which we want to do, if you're lacking that enthusiasm, generally speaking, enthusiasm comes by associating with enthusiastic devotees. So you have to find out somebody, if there's something which I want to do, some particular activity, then try to find out some devotee who has that enthusiasm. Now desires, enthusiasm is basically what? Enthusiasm is a sustained desire to keep moving on. So where do we get that desire from? We get desire from others. Our desires are not just linear, they are triangular. Linear desire means we see something, I want it. So it's with respect to, suppose there's some delicious dessert that we like and that dessert is there. Oh, I want to eat this. It's a linear desire. But suppose sometimes there's some dessert which we have never heard about. When I first went to Australia, the devotees there offered me something called baklava. I had never heard of baklava. Now the name is not a very pleasant name. So I said, okay, maybe later. Then we were there, several of us were taking prasadam, and I saw everybody else was taking, and they were all relishing it. So I said, so nice. I said, okay, give me one. So just seeing or hearing about the baklava did not create the desire, but seeing others relishing it created the desire. So that's how desire is not just linear, but it is triangular. That means we see somebody else doing that activity and that triggers our desire. So we may wake up in the morning and we see the alarm clock ringing. That may not create the desire with this, I have to wake up. But if we are friends with some, we have made friends with some other devotee, and that devotee also wakes up early, and then we encourage each other to wake up early, then we think, oh, this devotee is also going to wake me up, is also going to wake up, so let me also wake up. So then we may make a plan that, you know, when you wake up, just call somebody else, or that devotee calls us, whatever. Basically, if we want to develop enthusiasm, we need to associate with somebody who has enthusiasm. That is the single most important thing. Along with that, we can also use our intelligence to sustain the conviction. Buddhya dhriti gruhitaya. So find out, why do I want to get up? Okay, if I want to get up, it's just nice, I want to get up, I want to chant my rounds early, whatever, that's good. But write it down. Because the nature of the mind is that whatever sustains our determination, the mind deletes that from our memory. And whatever sustains our lethargy, the mind props it up. Hey, you know, you slept late yesterday, if you wake up too early, you will fall sick, this. So write down the reasons why you want to wake up, and then keep them readily accessible. Say, before we go to sleep, then look at them once. That way, we'll have that reminder. So at a level of association, at the level of our intelligence, if we create a support system for us to do what we want to do, then that enthusiasm will naturally come. Okay. So thank you very much. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Srila Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. Gaur Premanande. Jai.